It's well known that you are not only a philosopher interested in theology too, as we see in your book Crossing the Rubicon, but you are also a specialist in patristic and medieval philosophy. And you have a new trilogy, St. Bonaventure and the Entrance of God into Theology, God, Flesh and the Other, and the Book of Experience that's forthcoming. Could you tell us, what is the place of patristic and medieval philosophy in your work? What does it mean when you say that the question of experience comes first when you are reading the ancient texts? Is there not a danger of anachronism when you try to actualise the medieval philosophy?
So, thanks for your question. It's an important one. And you are right. I never began with philosophy of religion, with phenomenology. At the beginning, I am a specialist in medieval, in patristic and medieval philosophy. And that's why my first situation at ICP, at the Catholic University of Paris, where we are, it was, because now I change a bit, but it was patristic and medieval philosophy. That is the first point. But it's not only a question of institutional point. It is because for me, there is something in patristic and medieval philosophy which we need it today. What is it? It is not to separate so much philosophy and theology. And it's not the same in the case of the patristic and the case in the medieval philosophy. But there is something which is very important for me. It is what I call, at the beginning of God, Flesh and the Other, the theological reading of medieval philosophy. What does that mean? Of course, there is a danger to apply some contemporary categories to medieval authors, patristic authors. But I never did that and explained it. It is not anachronism. And many people say it's anachronism. No, because my question is not to say that Thomas Aquinas can respond to our question, that Bonaventure can respond to our question, or Scott Erigène can respond to our question, or Anselm of Canterbury, and all of them, and I wrote on all of them, and many, many, many authors. It is just to try to know what are their own questions, and what are their own responses, to understand how to give some response to our question. But the theme are the same. I take an example. I discovered in God, Flesh and the Other, because I spoke about Bonaventure before, I discovered Jean Scott Erigena. Jean Scott Erigena is a Carolingian, and he was a translator of Denis, Pseudo-Denis, and he developed a theophania, De Natura, theophania. And in fact, it's incredible, because at the beginning of his translation of Denis, he said that God appears. So what is an apparition? And he said exactly the words of Heidegger in Being and Time. He speaks about phenomena, phenomenon, and so on. So it doesn't mean, first, that Heidegger reads Scott Erigena, or that Scott Erigena is speaking as a phenomenologist, because he's not a phenomenologist, he's speaking about theology and theophania. But the manner to treat the question of theophania today, which is not apophatic theology, which is a difference, I think, between Marion and me on that point, but we don't speak about it. And I think that that we learn something from Scott Erigena. So that is a point. I give you a second example, which is the third chapter of God, Flesh and the Other. I explained to you just before that there is no separation between the orders in my work. What Augustine did, and it is an interesting point because the first papers I published when I was 26, something like that, or a bit more, it was the papers on Augustine about the De Trinitate. And I explained that in Augustine there was the Aristotelian categories, substance, quantity, quality, relation, and so on. And then I explained that he sued outside of the categories. But 10 years after, I came back to this text I wrote, I said, no, it's not right. Because at this moment, I was for the overcoming of metaphysics, and that is finished for me. If you read the end of the Crossing the Rubicon, there is a chapter which is overcoming the overcoming of metaphysics. We know that the Heideggerian ontology, it does not exist. I found it in Duns Scotus. In fact, it is not in Duns Scotus, it is in Thomas Derfurt. Thomas Derfurt, who is a pseudo Duns Scotus, when he wrote his dissertation on the theory of signification in Duns Scotus. And then Heidegger, he saw that the construction of the ontos, the word which is linked to otero sinologos, is a structure of theology. Of course, it's completely wrong. And during many years, during perhaps 20 years, all the students of Jean Marion tried to show that this author is not ontology, so Pascal is not, Duns Scot is not, and so on and so on. But now, my generation, we are not speaking anymore about ontology. We are not speaking anymore about the overcoming of metaphysics. There is a problem in France, I just said it, is the fact that now the young students who are for the metaphysics, they are sometimes against phenomenology, as the phenomenologists were against metaphysics. So it means nothing for me. This combat has no sense or no signification. And now I'm writing on spiritualism, French spiritualism, and I am the next titular of the Gison Chair in March, and I will give lectures on spiritualism and phenomenology, the case of Maine de Biran. So I give course now on Maine de Biran. So you see, so then I came back to just to Augustine, it was just a bracket. In fact, in my chapter, God, Flesh and the Other, there is a complete transformation of what I wrote before. Because this chapter, it is a chapter about the transformation of the categories and not the overcoming of the categories. Because what's happened, in fact, in the De Trinitate of Saint Augustine? In the book 5, Augustine, he takes back the Aristotelian categories. He's not thinking outside the categories. So what are the categories? I just said it. Substance, quantity, quality, relation, modality, situation, and so on. But it's impossible to keep the same categories, because if I keep only, I said to Augustine, the categories of substance, I will have three gods, treatism. If I keep all the other categories, contingent categories, I will fall in modality, modalism. But what did Augustine? He never overcome the categories. He took the fourth one and he put it at the third place. Substance, quantity, quality, relation, modality. He took the categories of relation and he said, if I want to think what is the Trinity, I need to take the fourth category, the relation, and to put it at the first place, because God in Christianity is relation. So, at this moment, you understand that he didn't overcome the Aristotelian categories. He transformed. That's why even the transformation of culture, and we don't have to think outside of the culture, and it is a very big difficulty in my mind, in the French phenomenology. And it is a good question that the theologian asks to the French phenomenology. So Augustine, he transforms the categories, he extracts the fourth one, and he put it in the third place. And what did Thomas Aquinas in his Summa Theologiae at the question 27? He spoke about the substantial relation. What does it mean? It means that if the relation in Trinity is now the first category, it is a category which is a substantial relation, because we don't have to forget that in Thomas, in Aristotle, the first category was the substance, but the concept of substance changed in Thomas Aquinas, because what is the substance is the act of given, and it's not only the substantial thing. So it is a second example, just to explain to you that my work in medieval philosophy, or my work on the patristic authors, is a place where I can find a manner to think. I can see what they did. exactly what I say about Thomas Aquinas as a contra gentiles. And we have to do today what they did for their time. Not the same thing, but what they did for their time.
When it comes to your own work, probably you are most well known in France for your phenomenological work. You are teaching in the Catholic University of Paris, where we are today, and your teaching is principally in philosophy, and especially in phenomenology. So coming back to phenomenology, I want to ask you about two of your books. You published a first book in phenomenology, which is The Loving Struggle, in debate with Derrida, Merleau-Ponty, Levinas, Henri, Marion, Lacoste, and so on. In your eyes, what are the conditions of the French debate in phenomenology today? You speak in your preface about the struggle of Jacob with the angel. So can you explain what that means? And you've also just published a book in French entitled Hors Phénomène, translated into English as The Extra Phenomenon. And you explain in this book that there is not only the infra-phenomenal and the supra-phenomenal, but also the extra-phenomenal. What do you want to convey by this distinction? Why and how are you developing a phenomenology of trauma today? What does it mean to be in crisis? Not only because the world is in crisis, we all know about the war in Ukraine, the climate crisis, and so on, but because there is no life without crisis. In what sense are we always alone, as you say at the end of your book?
So, thanks for this important and big question. Now we are coming on the last part of my work, and we spoke a lot about philosophy of religion, of course, and the trilogy and so on. We spoke a bit about medieval philosophy too. Here we are on my part of my work, which is only philosophical, only phenomenological. Of course, first, you quoted this book, translated in English, The Loving Struggle, in French, Le Combat Amoureux. Many students take it back, and many students are doing a loving struggle with me now. As I did it, and it's good. And I said, why not? Because they have to find their own way too. What does it mean? I told you that I am an Ignatian. What does it mean to be Ignatian? It means that it is discernment. Discernment. Discernment means I'm not thinking alone. And I'm not thinking in myself that you are the best, and what you are doing is absolutely original, and you do not discuss with the other, or you write that book, but you discuss with the other, but you don't quote the other. It is the inverse, because you need to have a sort of confrontation to find your own way. That's why, as you said, I quote in the preface of this book, The Loving Struggle, I quote the combat of Jacob with the angel. And for me, this passage of Genesis is so important for me. Why it is important? Because when Jacob enter in his combat with the angel, at a moment, the angel, or we don't know if it is an angel or human, in the text it's not so clear, he said, okay, now we can stop. We can stop the combat. What said not Jacob, what said the angel? And Jacob responded, I will not let you until you will bless me. What does it mean? It means that the combat is good. In fact, exactly what Saint Paul said. We have to have the good combat, what says Saint Paul. The combat is good. Why? Because it is our condition. We think, but it is completely false, that we are alone, and then we were in the paradise, then we fall in the combat, and then we will come back in the peace. But what sort of peace? In fact, we can't live without to be in front of the other equilibrium. Enfin, in front of it, it means that what the angel do? He break, is Moscow, here. And then it's impossible for Jacob to be as in 2 feet. He can't be alone, you know, because it is like a cathedral, arc-bouton, you are on the other. So it's impossible to be alone. So you need the other. It is like between man and woman. You need the other, not because you are against him, but because there is a resistance. And in my book, you spoke about the extra phenomenon. There's a chapter about the question of resistance. And for me, what is first? Not gift, but resistance is first. Because what I call the resistance of the presence. The resistance is first, not gift, because I can't exist without resistance. So the loving struggle is to say, okay, thanks to Derrida, thanks to Marion, thanks to Henri, thanks to Chrétien, and me, you are the way of my resistance by which I can find my own way. But it is the same with my friends, with my wife. So, but it is a good combat. In fact, it is Nietzsche who saw that in his first text on the tragedy, on the Greek, on the pre-Socratic, and he spoke about the agon. Agon. Agon is not polemos. Agon is a good combat. But if you refuse the combat, the good combat, that is the sin. What is the sin? And in theology too, it is the case of fall. You fall. And what you fall? Because you have nobody in front of you, there is no more resistance. If you refuse the resistance of the other, you fall on yourself, which is the sin. Or if you refuse the resistance of the other, you want to écrase to the other, which is a war. So what is a good combat between the sin and the polemos? It is the agon. So first point, I want to say that in our life, we are in resistance in front of the other, and this resistance is the way by which we can exist. There is a song in French, but not well known in English. This is France Gall. I quote it in my book, The Extra Phenomenon. Resist and then you exist. Voilà. Mais it's not combat. Hein? That is the first. So in that book, you spoke about the living struggle. I try to find my own way in front of my fathers and the others, the other generation. Then, you quoted my last book. So this last book, for me, is a very important one, only phonological. So there was conference at ICP with professor of Sorbonne, who will never read my book on philosophy of religion. It is only phonological. And it's an important point for me, not because I am only a philosopher, because my next book will be published in May, which is The Flesh of God, it will be theological. So, each time they say, now you are a true philosopher, so I publish a book in theology. Now you are a theologian, I publish a book in philosophy. I don't want, but I don't know what I have to do. You know, when you write books, it is like when you are painting, like Picasso. There are some periods, the blue period. So there are some periods in your life. And me, people are thinking that I have the idea to write first a book on the Holy Friday, and then I will write a book on the Only Sunday, and then I will write a book on the... Absolutely not. When I finished my first book on the Great Gethsemane, it was finished. I didn't believe anymore about resurrection. I spent 5 years to believe in it, because I bear the weight of the death to believe in resurrection. So I have no project. That's why we have to be careful when I speak about the trilogy and so on. It's not because I born with a system in my life, in my head. There is no system. I don't know what I have to do. So what's happened in that book, the extra, le hors phénomène? In fact, I wrote that book during the crisis of the COVID. So important. Perhaps in a moment of my life where something was difficult in my health because of illness. I don't have this illness, but I thought I will have it, so it's very important for me. And I experienced, as I said, how the French phenomenology was not able to help me in the case of the trauma. But it was not as in the Winning Feast of the Lamp, which was, I need something to find something else, which was the abyss, for discover what the Eucharist means. But it is something else, which is what is the trauma. So, and I explain in that book, it's very important for me, even if it's being complicated, that you have, in the phenomenology, you have two forms of phenomenology. The German one, which I call infra-phenomenal. Infra-phenomenal, it means that when the phenomenology began, the question was to know how, when something will appear, what something, if something appears, something prepares the apparition, which I call a propedeutic of phenomenology. So, well, I don't want to speak to the specialist, not a question to speak, but for example, Husserl spoke about the flux of consciousness. Heidegger spoke about the withdrawal of the phenomenon. It has to appear. Or Husserl and Merleau-Ponty spoke about the world of life, le monde de la vie. So it prepares. Something prepares the phenomenon. Then you have the French phenomenology, which is absolutely the inverse. What we call the inverse intentionality, which is no, nothing prepares. There is a face of Levinas, there is a gift of Marion, there is a liturgy of Lacoste. It exceeds you. But if you said that something prepares the apparition, or if you said that something exceeds the apparition, in the two cases, you are always here. And if something exceeds the apparition, I'm here. I can't contain the apparition, but it appears to me the relation, no problem. But in a case of a trauma, and I quote 5 examples in my book, The Extra Phenomenon, not yet published, it is in translation, a big book. I explain that there are five examples. Illness, separation, death of a child, natural disaster, and pandemic. And why I choose those 5 examples? Because those 5 examples are without cause and without sin. You can say today that you have an illness because of the sin. The illness is illness. And if you lost a child, you can say that. And it's very important for me, it is the same in the case of a separation. I have many friends who separated. And in fact, they constat that they are separated. What's happened to us? Of course, you can say because it is without any fault. So this point is very important, and that's why the extra phenomenon, what it is? It is a structure of a counter-structure of the transcendental in Kant. It means, it's complicated, it means that you have the trauma, but in the case of the trauma, everything is broken. The difference between the German phenomenology, everything is prepared, or in the French phenomenology, everything is overcoming on you, you are blocked. You are separated, you are blocked. You lost a child, you are blocked. And blocked, it means there is no more horizon phenomenalized, and there is no more subject to phenomenalizing. So, I'm broke. And what is the worst? The worst is not that something worst could happen. Something worse has to be separated. No. The worst is the fact, it's a bit complicated, the worst is the fact that nothing worst or better can happen to me. You understand that? It means that in the case of a separation, in the case of an illness, you don't feel anything anymore because you lost the capacity of feeling. Exactly what happened, for example, in the camp of Auschwitz. It's what explained Charlotte Delbault. She's a French who came back from the camp. And she said, I do not feel anything. That is the case of the trauma. So this point is very important. Why? Because we stop with a form of phenomenology which is only developed for the people who are good, who are good in their life. I received a message from a man with a poetry yesterday, and he told me, oh, what a liberation for me to read this book, because it responds to my experience, and it was not enough to read the others. So it's not against, it is something else. So what's happened in the case of the trauma? In the case of the trauma, you are completely destroyed. What I call the desubjectivation, no more subjectivation. But you are always in life. There is something which is worse than the anguish of death, we spoke about Heidegger, which is the insomnia. Exactly what Levinas said. Why? Because in the case of the anguish of death, you are here, you are thinking about your death, and you are asked to yourself what meaning, what sense you can give to your life before you died. Exactly what I told about, okay, and very important. But the worst that point, on that point, it is insomnia. What is insomnia? Is the fact to be here and to prefer to not be here. So we are not only some people who live thinking about our death, we are survival. And when you experience a trauma, you are survival. And you say, and it is the definition of crisis in my book, there's a chapter on crisis. What is crisis? Is the fact to be astonished, to be always there, instead to be dying. I am always present. Okay, and in that case, I suppose there is no resignation. I'm completely against the concept of resignation, which is the concept of resiliency. You know that? Is very well known. What does it mean? For me, it is a laicization of the structure of nature and grass in theology, but a bad transcription. Because, okay, what is resiliency? Resiliency said, okay, you fall, never mind. You have to be resilient. So you have to wake up. So, okay, you have a sportive, you fall. So, now, when a sportive failed, he said, no problem, I learned a lot. What does that mean? You have to stay in your trauma. So I explain in the book that we are on our trauma, it is a portance and continence, but no resilience. I have to stay where I am. Okay, so where I am, but I can't recognize me as a subject. I said in English that the subject is hors-jeu. Hors-jeu en français, out of me, but out of game. Because you can write hors-jeu, J-E, and hors-jeu, J-E-U. So yes, there is a play on the word in French, hors-jeu, it means I out of me, c'est en français, hors de lui, but out of the game. And so you are hors-jeu, but your subject is always present. So your person bear on yourself. Exactly what Augustine said, and it was so commentated by Heidegger, oneri me sum, I am await for me. But I am await because I am always present. So first, you are desubjectivation, but then you are hyper-subjectivate in the meaning of your subject being on you. Then what's happened in a case of a true trauma? You lost your identity. You can't say anymore, I am, you are, because you do not recognize yourself and the people do not recognize you. And we have to go until this point. The only one who saw that in the history of philosophy is Spinoza. Because in his Ethics, Spinoza quotes the case of the poetry, the poet Góngora, who is a Spanish poet. And he said he lost his memory. We think it is a form of Alzheimer. And he said in Latin, he lost in the ruin, and then he changed of his nature. It is not the same nature. It changed in his substance. So that is the word. So there is a sort of desubstantialization. So in that way, if there is first a sort of destruction of the subject, then the subjects continue to exist. And at this point, I don't speak about the destruction of the subject as Foucault. Then there is a subjectivation because you exist, and then there is a hyper-subjectivation, which is a sort of transformation. In fact, at the end of a crisis, or in a crisis, you are completely transformed. In fact, I quote a leitmotif, which is very important in this book, which is so much exception, so much transformation. So it is a coming back to Heidegger, because Heidegger said so much apparency, so much being, autant d'apparence, autant d'être. And Jean-Luc Marion said so much reduction, so much donation givenness. And me, I said so much exception, so much modification. What is, if I have an exception in my life, which is an illness, a separation, a death of a child, a natural catastrophe or a pandemic, I'm completely broken. And in that way, in the case of this exception, I'm completely transformed. So what I call the hyper-transformation. So you have the concept of hyper-transformation in the extra phenomenon, and the concept of metamorphosis of finitude about the resurrection in my book of metamorphosis of finitude. The question is how to link the two. But it is a true question for me. It is like the cancrela, how you say the cancrela, the beast in Kafka.
Yes, the giant insect.
Yes, exactly. So the cancrela, and Kafka said, I became the cancrela, and in that case, is absolutely not the same. He does not recognize himself, he's not recognized by his sister. So we have to accept to be completely changed. And then there is a question, because in that case, in the case of the trauma, how is your life? I explained that your life, it is like wall on a tissue, there are wall. And Jacques Lacan, I don't quote often Lacan, but Jacques Lacan said, it's not only traumatism in French, but traumatism. It's not only traumatism, but traumatism, true war. So you lost a child, very tragic, and then you have a war in your life. And we all have war in our life. It's impossible to go in the war, in our war, because we will explode. But the war are there at the beginning, in fact, what Deleuze called the failure, failure. And in the case of a trauma, I can go around the wall, but I'm always alone. Because even your wife, even your husband, he can't live anything of what you are living. And in the case, for example, of a death of a child, they always say, you can't feel. So what is love? Love is not the attempt to feel what the other is feeling. Love, now you will be perhaps a bit astonished by this definition, but love is not the place of communicability. Love is incommunicability. What does it mean? Of course, it does not mean that we don't have to communicate. But the last chapter of the book is about solitude, the originary solitude. And I explain that we forget the concept of solitude in phenomenology, because we are always talking about the solitary, for example, in Rousseau, about solipsism in Husserl, about to be alone in Heidegger. But solitude, for me, it is a core. I speak about the core of solitude, not the mystery of solitude. Because when we speak about the mystery of solitude, you have something to share, but you can't share everything. As you speak about the mystery of the Eucharist. No, it's not the case. The core of solitude, it means that there is a wall in myself. I can't rejoin it. I can't reach it. So what is love? I love you because I know that there is something in yourself, and sometimes revealed in the case of the trauma. There is something in yourself that you can't reach, that I can't reach. And you know that there is something in myself that I can't reach myself, and that you can't reach our joy, and our love is our commune incommunicability. But we are very far from the apophatic theology in that way. What does it mean? It means that exactly what Rainer Maria Rilke said in his very important book in my mind, which is a letter to a young poet, hein, Monsieur Capus, and he said, what is love? Love is two solitudes who congratulate themselves and who salute themselves. It means that love, to be in love, is to recognize that I am alone. But it is a good loneliness, a good solitude, because of the trauma, there is something in me that I can't reach and that you can't reach. And this is what is a place where we can be in love. When you are married for a long time, my case, you know that you don't have to speak with your wife to understand what she's feeling and to understand that she will never reach what we're speaking about and you will never reach. But I love you because of that. So in that way, I think that there is a sort of realism, but I don't like a lot this word, a realism of the original solitude revealed by the trauma. We are so far of the mystic of the other developed in Levinas, Marion, and so on, huh? In that way. And then the last question, see, so what can I do with the extra phenomenon in theology, in philosophy of religion? So I wrote a text, and it will be published in my next book, The Flesh of God. When I explain, I discover that the Holy Saturday is the place where God reaches us in our trauma. Because we forget this day of the Passion of Christ. In Catholic theology, many traditions, I think, not in the Orthodox one, of course. And the Holy Saturday is coming from the Jewish tradition. It is the Sheol in the Book of Job, in the Psalm. And what is the Sheol? It is absolutely not the place of the sin. The Sheol is the place where I don't want to be forgotten by God. And God, who is God? The one who will not forget Adam. So he will go to take Adam. But in my mind, salvation is not to put someone out of where he is. Because of course you can be somewhere in a sin or a bad situation, ask to God to put you out of it. You can meet a priest, and 2 days after you can you fall again in this place. So for me, God, love and salvation is not to be alone. Even in the case of the original solitude, you are alone, I said, you are in solitude. But the other is behind you, not behind, near you. And as human beings, we can be near. And it's a lot. That's why, for me, the Dasein, or the being there, is not an act of opening, I completely get that, but only the act to be here. Exactly when someone is in illness, you are present at the hospital. But in the case of the Saturday, in the case of Christ, even if you are a believer, it's not better, it's different, because I always say that if you're a believer, it's not better, it's different, huh? Because of what we have in common. In the case of believing, God is not only near you, but he is with you, Emmanuel. Voilà. It means that because God resurrected, he can be with me in my trauma. So, what is the Holy Saturday? It is a moment where I recognize who I am, not in sin, because I have a concert, because I lost a child, because it was impossible to leave the pandemic, and so on. But of course, the examples are all different. And God is present with you because of this. I know you lost your child, and I cry with you. With you, I not only near you. So you see how what was first a pure phenomenological work is taken again and transformed in a theological way. Now, to come back to your first question, do I am a philosopher or a theologian? I don't mind. It's not a question. The question is to be in unity of ourselves.
Brilliant. It's good.
Okay, I think it's good, huh? We finished,
that's
on
right
that?
Way to
yeah.